Oh, I just find I'm nervous. I know. Okay.
Just say your name.
Sally Stewart.
And how many children do you have?
I have 3 living and 5 children in total. So I found out I was pregnant. I just knew I was pregnant. I didn't realise I had twins. So we went in and had this ultrasound, and the lady said, there's 2 in there. There's 2. We nicknamed them Lefty and Righty because they were, one was on the left and one was on the right, and they were very active babies and, you know, twisting and turning, and Mike and I were always laughing that they were like having an acrobatic sort of show going on, and so we nicknamed them Lefty and Righty. I used to take a photo every week, every Friday, just of my profile, just as I was getting bigger and bigger. And there was a really big jump between sort of the 20th week and the 21st week. I just sort of went whoosh, and it was like a regular person at full term pregnancy with a single baby. I'd just gone whoosh, and it was a real concern to me, and I actually went and saw the obstetrician at 21 weeks, 21 and a half weeks. So what happened, I went and saw him, and he, you know, felt me around and said, no, there's plenty of fluid there, but you know, you should be right. So what happened that night, I felt really, really uncomfortable, and I went to the toilet during the night and I was spotting. Now, I panicked, like the walls were caving in. But I didn't really know what it meant. I just, you know, people spot all the time, and I know that it freaks every pregnant woman out when they spot, because it's just, you know, it's terrifying. But what happened was it was actually part of the whole birthing process. I was in labour and I was unaware. I then rang the hospital, Masada Hospital, which is where I was booked to have the boys, and they told me to come in. So next thing you know, it's sort of the middle of the night and I'm in hospital. Then my obstetrician walked in and he just said, Sally, you're in labour. And, you know, I'm really sorry to tell you, but the children are, they're too young and they won't be viable. And it's not going to play out very well. And I was furious. And I had been talking to the head midwife of Masada. She had been sitting with me. She was an extraordinary lady. She just said to me, look, if your babies are born in this hospital, we do not have a neonatal ward. So we don't have the capacity to care for babies that are prematurely born. So you will be transferred like in an emergency situation. But your doctor is saying that there's no viability, so there's no need, you should just stay here and let's just do it nicely and I'll be with you the whole time. And, you know, she was beautiful. And I said, no, I'm not giving up. I'm going to go, where can I go? And she said, well, you can go to Monash. So I actually had a fight. I had a full fight with my obstetrician, and I pretty much discharged myself. So he refused to discharge me. I ordered an ambulance to transfer me from Masada to Monash. And had washed my hands of my obstetrician. And I remember getting into that ambulance and Michael was in the car behind me, following me, and I could see him the whole drive. And I just said, look, we're just gonna, every day we can buy with them in me is an extra day. You know, we'll get as far ahead as we possibly can. Anyway, it's a very long story, but in the end, I held out for a few days and I met this beautiful obstetrician, John Regan. Sorry. It's okay. In the end, they were born. I couldn't stop it. They tried so hard. But they were born. And they were 22 and a half weeks. And they were just too little. What had happened was that Righty was the baby that had been not getting all the goodness, and Lefty had been. So Righty had actually sort of triggered the labour because he was going to die. And he was stillborn, which means that he, when he was born, he was the first one to be delivered. He was dead. Whereas Lefty was actually alive. He was alive for about half an hour. And it was quite surreal. The whole thing is like a nightmare in slow motion. So Lefty, even though he was alive, his eyes were fused shut. They were never going to open. But he was like the size of the palm of my hand. But Michael and I held him for half an hour until his heart stopped beating. But it was nice to have that time with him. What a lot of people do when they go through this traumatic experience is some people, you know, want to stay in the hospital for days and hold their babies for days. Some never want to see them. They don't even hold them. They don't want to touch them. Others, like me, just wanted to spend every moment I could. But then when it was over, I just wanted to go home. So physically, I was feeling terrible because I'd been having this live circus show go on inside me every day, and it was all exciting and fascinating, and then all of a sudden I literally had nothing inside me, and that hollow feeling, it's the worst feeling I've ever had. So we told all our friends and family, and oh, that was so good. They were just amazing. What I found the most comforting was that people, and often not my closest friends or family, often people I barely knew, rang me and told me their stories about how they'd lost their children. And I found that extraordinary because, and I honestly have always felt since then that hearing someone else's story that can be similar to yours normalises what you're feeling. Often makes you feel a little bit better because everyone's story always sounds worse than your own. The strength of hearing someone else's story was so empowering because it just normalised you. There wasn't something super wrong with you. It's really difficult to say when it gets better because there's no defining moment. I don't think it ever got better, really. Like, grand scheme of things, I still have boys that aren't with me. I have sons that would be 19 this year. You only know what you've got. I know what I've got. I've got boys that died, and I've got three beautiful children that lived. I'm happy with my lot. I've got plenty of scars, but, you know, how good is our life?
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.